First of all, let me start to show you what can be done using GXX Graph, what kind of simulation and graphic explanation. First of all, I have this kind of, for example, this kind of simulation. I can explain law of reflection of light, drag light source, and explain how it works and how our eye see the image when it's reflected in the mirror. And immediately after that, they can ask to make some training and answer the question. Here I just completed it before because I don't want to drag too many rays. It takes time. As you can see, it's already completed. And then if you go, this is next question, it's just partly completed task and they have to continue to drag this rays. See how it works with other examples. I can show you, this is a simulation of simple harmonic motion. As you can imagine, it's an energy transformation during the oscillation. You can drag this mass on the string and see what's going on with different kind of energy. And you can also start animation and see how it works in progress. And you can change initial amplitude and see what's going on. Again, all of the simulation are followed by some kinds of Moodle formulas, and students should accomplish it and to complete their understanding of the learning material. Another example, it's simulation of electric field lines and magnitude. You can switch between positive and negative charges, move these charges and see what's going on. And you can also observe vector of the electric field and vector of the force and see what is direction of the field and force when you switch charges from negative to positive. You can see that it's changed the direction to the opposite. Another nice example, it's an explanation of one-dimensional motion. It's very beginning of the course of physics when you start kinematics with the 10th grade students. You can show students what's going on when you drag zero point, when you change axis direction. You can start movement animation, and you can discuss with the student that it's they have to do some additional things to describe this type of movements, what can help us to understand what's going on. It's both tracking and graph. So it can create graph, different two types of movement. And then always we can you can follow it with a corresponding question in that I do it in model formulas. Okay, it's a very simple question. When I plot simple graph of the position time movement, and student should answer two simple question: initial position and velocity. You can calculate from the parameter that he got from the graph. I can give you a brief look what's going on inside this question. This is two type of variables we have. This is random variables, and I just select three of it. It's initial position, velocity, and some period of time, because I usually don't my graph is a different time scale. And here I have in the variables I have I do some calculation that I need to construct GXX graph. It means I define what should be a proper limits to this graph, and here in the text of the question I create few codes of JavaScript. These parameters were taken from the model formulas, and I plot graph according to these parameters I defined before. The interesting maybe detail of programming I'm using, it's you can see here the tough part of the formulas. It's to construct a different part of question. If I want to answer more than one number to be answered, I have to create it. And usually, as you will see later, I use many parameters, very complex, construct very complex questions. And for that reason, I just find it's much easier way to do it. It's to put the question from here to define as a variable, a string variable, the question, and answer as well. And only thing I have to do, it's just probably see if I want to put here units. It's the thing, it's only thing I should to correct when I copy one question to another. It's of course, you already have seen a lot of examples, and there is course that you have in GXX graph that describes how to start to create this kind of questions. And I will try to discuss with you in a completely different matter. When I start to create it, this question, I very, very fastly find out that there is enormous number of scenarios of question, of type of question I can create. I can tell the different story, and the question I asked myself as a teacher was what type of question I should introduce to my student, because they are limited in time, and I don't want to lose their attention, and don't want them to get boring and to lose interest to the subject, to the learning. And for that reason, I will ask you to this, will share with you some kind of my understanding, but we have to go now to completely different matter. It's psychology. Let me show. I started to think of what is really the learning process, to understand how to, because I want to do it as effective as possible. This is a very widely used schematic presentation. Many people think that learning is just to process when we expand this little spot of what of our present knowledge to this area that it's something unknown. But if I go to some psychology knowledge and try to understand what's going on through this process, I can find that it's not as simple as we can suppose it to be. For example, there's theory of Lev Vygotsky that discuss this problem and introduce a zone of proximal development. And the statement is that there is a relatively thin layer of our knowledge when we can student can progress if they guide it, and if we'll try to introduce some task that exceeded this zone of proximate development, we will fail. They will fail. And if you can, if we want to keep successful learning, we have to carefully plan these steps and guide our students from one small step to another. Another thing, interesting thing that I found in psychology, it's that this area, what we want to learn our student, usually we suppose that it's lack of knowledge, that it's absence of knowledge, it's empty page, blank page. But in fact, in many cases, there are full of some misconceptions. It means some concept that you student already somehow built up from their previous life experience. And if it's false concept, it can be it can contradict with knowledge. We can we try to introduce them, and then it will be also a failure. Actually, misconception, it's not lack of conception, it's alternative conception, as I mentioned before. And these naive ideas that our students already have about the subject we try to learn them, they really make some coherent concept. It means it built in some logic way, and when it's already built up, it's relatively rigid to new changes. If you introduce new piece of facts on evidence, they didn't get it, because it's well known from coherence theory. And how to construct our training in case to make this conceptual change effective. And what was found, there are some researches in this area that shows that lectures, teachers lectures is a relatively ineffective way when we try to explain our students some new concept. Sometimes they can can have very, very big difficulties to accept these new facts, because it's in contradiction of they already think about this subject. And proposed way is to let students face this contradiction by some students-led activities. And as and now we're going on to the model and to the formulas, you can easily understand that model and digital training at all, it actually provides us very, very good tools to do it. And actually, I have can explain us, give us a guiding line how to build our training. One of the interesting example with graph, for example, and it was found that some students can analyze this graph and calculate slopes. I will go back, sorry. You have this graph, and randomly it's these formulas select us zero velocity. It means this object doesn't move. And what students supposed to do, just analyze this question: resting, motion direction, resting, and crossing zero, not crossing zero. That's why they have to understand from this graph. And if you do the same, start to the same, completely the same question next time, it will get, they will get something completely different. Constant velocity, it goes against axis direction, and again, this time it's not crossing 0 point. And this type of question you can understand from this some probably boring psychological introduction, very much, much more helpful for students to get the true concept, physical concept, because with number, many of the students, they usually deal very good with numbers, and they can perform calculation in very good way, but still don't understand what is the meaning of this formula. And this type of question that we can create in a formula helps much more. This is another type of question I created. As far as you can see now, it's already velocity time. And for that reason, it's already constant acceleration. And object changes direction, and but we cannot say if cross zero line or no, because velocity time function doesn't provide us enough information for this. What's interesting in this question is in internal structure. I will show you, give you a brief look. Actually, you can see that I have pulled six, I have here six different scenarios with both constant velocity motion and constant acceleration and resting, and even piecewise function from two pieces of constant velocity. And actually, anytime when I start this type of question, I will get something wrong, some different type of class. This is resting, and next time I will try. Sorry, it's resting again. Let's try, have another try. Okay, we are not lucky. For that reason, I will show you how I can keep it if I want to present some specific scenario. I just put it here and cancel this randomization of this parameter, and now I will get a function from two pieces of constant velocity, and this time it doesn't change directions against axis direction, and cross 0.1s. All of this type of question can be presented to a student, and then they train understanding rather than practice just simple calculations. Let me show you how it goes with a real training block. This is the second law of Newton, accelerometer. It's a very typical system. I present to my students this kind of simulation. I just want to stress some very important thing, that this simulation doesn't use numbers. It's, in most cases, I try to keep it parametrically, because numbers just take the focus of student to the numbers and not to the, to the point of the concept. Here I have some explanation, and then we go to the training. First type of question, it's a very simple one. They just see this picture and they have to understand what is the direction of acceleration. It's to the right, but velocity we cannot say, because we don't have enough information. We check both of questions. And then I introduce new elements. And finally, we go to the most complex number. For example, this type of question, velocity time function and student, sorry. Yeah, velocity function. And now you have, they have 13 different questions, actually 12, and they have to analyze everything. This time it's inertial motion, it's constant velocity and so far. And finally, in this case, this small ball that it's connected to the ceiling of the car is keeps zero angle with the vertical because it's inertial motion, and they can go through all this strategy sequence until they come to the final solution of what should be the right angle of this car, in this case, when they get acceleration value from the graph. Here you can see another example. I already solved it for you before. This time it's already not inertial because we can see that this velocity time graph it just represents constant acceleration motion. All of these parameters of this characteristics of this motion, they have go through all this process, and finally they found this number of this displacement of angle of the string, and they have to put it on the right position. By the way, I put it 17 degrees, but in wrong direction, and it will show us that it's not right if somebody still have the problem. And if they put drag this position in the right position, they will see that it's right answer. And this is more or less guideline that helps me to understand how to construct quizzes that can be more effective for my student, and can help them to progress very fastly. Surprisingly, and another thing that I didn't put as a purpose, but I just saw it from the experience that students are so excited when they do this kind of training. They use discussion, they help each other to understand. And in many cases, I even didn't give explanation before this task. I just give them this this kind of quizzes, and they can understand things without my explanation by themselves. It's effective way, as we saw before, to break some misconception that probably existed at an cannot detect it before. This is another example of this kind of strategy. This is simulation of density and this think of lot principle. It's object that have lower density will float in the liquid, and if density of this ball is will be more than density of liquid, it will sink to the bottom. I don't show you all the sequence of questions, but first, very first question is let's go probably here. I already saw it, yeah. First question is very simple. I just have to understand what is the meaning of this number on the picture, put it in the right window, and to implement it to the original formula for density, mass divided by volume. But then I go and make it things more and more complicated, and finally I come to this kind of question. Here you can see we have two vessels. One is with liquid, and then the same vessel, and we just drop this ball into this liquid. And here with liquid, this is exactly the same process, but here we don't have mass and volume of this ball presented directly. We have to understand that volume, it's difference between this volume and this volume. This is 5 cubic centimeters that were added by this ball, and the same thing with mass. But the most interesting thing, it's last question, average density of liquid and ball together. I introduce this question without explain what average density is, and some of our students can try to average these two numbers, and they immediately have a Moodle response that show them that it's not correct answer. But some of students already can have a more deeper understanding, and they understand that they just have to divide these two numbers, and it will be number that it will be correct answer. Let me show you. I made it calculation before. Okay. Okay. We already have it from the model. And if when I introduced this task for the student in the classroom, I don't explain again, student that can get this right idea about what average density is, explained to their friends, and it goes much more easily. And what it's most important, that I can be sure that every student that complete this task, they already understood this concept. And actually Moodle gives me, provides me tools to check the progress of every individual student and see where they stop their progress, where at which point of training they have some difficulties. And even more examples I can show you at also did some kind of this logic without GXX graph in chemistry. This is very standard type of question. My colleague, I'm not a chemistry teacher, спасибо, colleague of mine, provide me this example. What we have to do, we just have to multiply to these numbers and to these some numbers. But finally, I have to decide whether it's a basic acid or neutral. Let's try both of them. This is another terminology when pH range it's above the 7 it's basic, below 7 it's acid, and equal 7 means neutral. So it's acid, so it should be here below. Of course, we have to do this two multiplication before we decide if we really want to solve this equation properly. And sorry. And finally, what I'm suggesting to do when student I have already trained to do this kind of logic, they can be introduced by this question when they just have to do to give final answer and do all this analysis without being guided by these elements of formula question. This is more or less logic of what I wanted to present you. If you have any question about technical details of construction of these questions I presented you, I'll be happy to make some comments. Some of these questions are really long code of hundreds and even thousands, but actually I'm not a Trova programmer. I did a lot of programming during my life, but it's not always for programming purposes. I always did it for some other goal. And here my goal is to teach students effectively, and I hope I can explain myself this my idea. And codes with what I do, I'm not sure that it's always very elegant codes from programming point of view.